यस इट्स अ पेज कॉल्ड मीरा फाउंडेशन.
ओह अच्छा
Good evening, everyone, and today we are again present with another episode of Reflections, a program that has the objective of bringing out some real stories that can set some example, that can enlighten us, that can guide us for resilience, for equanimity, for navigating some of the challenges that any of us, or especially as parents, we might go through. This program is not prescriptive of anything specific, neither it recommends any center or therapy or place to go for, but it is rather a way of connecting with people, a way of creating a sense of community, creating a sense of ecosystem with all those who are in the same journey, in a way, working with children, working with their challenges, working in that whole process with our own challenges as well, be it be professional, be it be parents, or be it be anybody who is concerned with difficulties, developmental challenges, and children. So today we have with us Ms. Seema Lal, and she is known to me since many, many years now. And she is a psychologist. She is a special educator. She works for children with difficulties. She is a mother who had her own journey, who had her own experiences, exposure to certain similar things as her profession was. And she's also an active researcher as of now. So inviting and welcoming you, Seema Lalji, and I would want to start with to know about a little bit more in detail about your journey as a student of psychology, as somebody who went on to becoming a professional, and then also who became a mother. What was your journey about? What was the things that you could kind of summarize in that journey?
Okay. Firstly, thank you so much, Manishji, for this opportunity because, yeah, you have been a great support of Together We Can on our journey. So this is very grateful for all your help so far and ahead as well. So, yeah, starting as a student, I think it was wanting to understand myself has probably pushed me to learn psychology, because I was not a very easy teen myself and not a very easy young adult who, so I think it was more about understanding people and understanding myself, which probably led me to study, graduate in psychology. But post the graduation and master's, moved to special education. Now thinking of it, probably because children was an area of interest, but the minute you became a professional, when I did my special ed course and you get this RCI license, suddenly, everybody is like blessing you. Wow, you're doing such noble work, suddenly you develop a halo around you just because you're working with the most vulnerable population, which is children. And as a young adult, then I was very flattered, ego boost, you were like, okay, you're going to change the world. My first work was in Tamil Nadu. And in Tamil Nadu, the people really treat you like God. So, it's really worshipping, especially when you're going for community work. So that was a very, so for me, professional means you are sorted, you know it all. You are there in a position to help others. So the hierarchy was very clear. That was what I started off as a professional, which was shot down very soon into my career, where I realized one of my teachers, probably she doesn't realize it now, but there was a child who developed a very strong dependency on me, because only if I work with the child, he would work. So for me, it was very flattery. Even the mother was very happy. Child is very happy with me. Child is progressing also. But I had to take a leave and the child refused to work with anybody, regression. So when I came back and resumed work, I thought, okay, everybody was grateful. The mother was like, oh, thank you for coming back. So I was very proud of myself. So, what a wonderful professional this child can do. But then my teacher then, and that was my early 20s, then really, I don't know, she put me down there and what have you done? So that is when the realization hit that, you know, as a professional, if you're making the child and the parent dependent on you, you are the biggest failure. That was the first learning for me from having this big halo and, you know, I am helping everybody and everybody's blessing me too. Hello, you know, we are all together in this. This is your job. Your job is to make sure that the others, you know, that's your job, that, you know, they are not dependent on you. So that was the first realization. But then I changed jobs. I moved a little bit to mental health and adults briefly. There also, it was with the Banyan. So there, Vandana and Vaishnavi, I was working very closely with them. That was their initial years. So a lot of dignity was placed on working with the most vulnerable population. And that was very important because I valued my dignity. So why shouldn't I value anybody else's? Why should we see it differently for a child or anybody else? Just because they are dependent, don't they deserve the same kind of dignity and respect? But as the journey progressed, after marriage, I moved to another country. Why I'm saying country here is I don't want to bring personal names and anything so that, you know. So there was this very, very famous professional who was following a specific method of working with children with autism, very successful. So I was associated with her. I was going for home visits. That's when I started home visits and got to know what actually happened inside homes. Earlier, the child and mother is coming to us in a clinic. That's very, very different when you are going for home. That is when I didn't have children of my own. I was very young. So I would go to several homes and then I realized that a lot can be done within homes. So unknowingly, though I was asked to go there only to work with the child and come back, I just started working with the mothers, telling them that, hello, it's nothing, it's not rocket science, you can do it. But that didn't go down very well with the professional who had hired me. And then I realized that why is that so? Then I saw the money. The profit-making business industry was very clear to me then in that country. And I just didn't want to continue there. So thankfully we could come back to India. And I joined a clinic here. But then I completely stopped working directly with children and decided that I'm only going to be work with mothers. At the same time, I became a mother myself. And then all the more reason that I knew for sure how much a mother can do. And my son did have significant difficulties with language. Most of those checklists that we would fill for autism then would have ticked off for him as well. But I didn't see myself panicking. There was no diagnosis because I didn't take him for any assessment because I was a professional myself. I had all the teaching aids, the flashcards, everything I had with me because I was working. So for me, it was a very natural. There was no this, you know, oh, getting a diagnosis, grief, shock, guilt, nothing happened. So then I thought that, hey, if I can do that with my child. It took me 4 years. It took me 4 years of extensive one-on-one work with my child with no support from anybody. Nobody knew. Even now, I rarely talk about it because if I talk about it now, people will dismiss it. Oh, Chumma, she's, you know, it was a, you know, just autism is not curable. Of course, that's what we learned. So for me, then that was more intriguing. That first few years that I could work made a huge difference. He's 14 years now. So that is when I realized the extent of vulnerability of a mother. At the same time, the amount of power that a mother has. So these two were like contrast and clashing. And I was wondering what is happening. That's when we moved to India. And like I said, I started working with mothers. But all these mothers were going to therapy centers. They would come to me only to find out, what do we do at home? So I said, hey, you're going to all these therapy centers and still you don't know what to do with your child at home. So why are they still coming to me? This was very intriguing, but trust me, I never questioned it. I thought, okay, let them come. I never really thought much about it. But soon the mothers started telling me not so good stories about what was happening inside, or they even told me they were not even inside in the first place. They are not even inside a therapy room. This is, I'm specifically talking about Kerala. So that intrigued me, but no mother was willing to talk about it for years. And I also felt that, okay, what can I do? Because I'm not the direct affected party. So what will I do unless at least one mother speaks up? So they would change from one therapy center to another. And this would continue until fortunately or unfortunately, Preeta, who's also one of the co-founders of Together We Can, Preeta's son, he broke his arm. He was 6 years then, broke his arm during a therapy session. That is when, you know, some point you reach enough is enough, right? You know, after a lot of things, you reach a point where that's it, I'm done with this, I cannot take it anymore. And thankfully, Preeta also reached that stage around the same time, and it clicked. It just clicked that, you know, Preeta said yes. I said, Preeta, can we please take this up? We didn't know what exactly to do, but she said yes. For me, that one yes from a mother was enough. That is all that we need to turn the vulnerability into power. And once that power comes, then there is no stopping. That I really realized, that there is no stopping. And I that is I think that's where we managed to reach this far, because I think we had enough of being vulnerable. That was the thing. Yeah, so that's in brief how we reached till starting TWC.
Sure. So, like you said, that you had pretty long journey before even you became a mother as a professional. Also, you have seen the profession, you have seen professionals very closely.
Yeah.
And then you had a mother, and you also had some brush of brushing up with the challenges or the challenges that a mother might face when their children have developmental delays or difficulties. Yes. For some amount of years, you did had a similar situation with you. So how did you then kind of switch or think of going towards activism from being a professional and a mother? What made you kind of have that feeling to say it's not just about only about coping with my own child? It's not just about coping. It's not just about managing my own mental health or managing or uptaking the skill deficits in my child, but it's also about actually doing something much more than what I am already going through or I have already seen also.
Yeah.
So a lot of people will have an exposure or will see things happening around them, but would kind of, in a way, kind of not really accept, but they're aware, they know it, but then life goes on, right?
Yeah.
So.
Yeah.
What made you kind of take a decision and think and decide that I need to take up activism?
Yeah.
And what was activism for you? Or what did it entail?
Yeah.
Right? What did it entail in the first initial phase?
I think it was more of not a choice, but it was, I also sat waiting for a long time saying, okay, oh, this is all not right. Somebody has to do something. And who is the somebody? Nobody knows. So finally, you reach a point where let us be the somebody and do it. And as I said, it really clicked. It was a right, unfortunately. There was sometimes it has to hit close to you, isn't it, for us to really do something. And for me, Preeta's, I was working closely with Preeta at that point of time. So for me to see her, I called her, what happened? I have not heard you for long. And she cried. I will not forget that tears. And the sentence that she told me in Malayalam, of course, that this is our fate. So, and I put the phone down and I said, seriously, this has to be the fate. And that is when I decided that, okay, now I'm also a professional. My son did not need that kind of a support. So what we thought of doing, let's start meeting the professional and find out why is it that they cannot allow parents inside. What happens if a mother or the father sits inside and sees the therapy and supports the child and learns what they need to do? What happens? Fine, you make the money, you make your profit, it is fine. I'm not saying everybody should do free service. No. Okay, so what was it? So what we did was activism started, I think, on thanks to two professionals. The center in which this child's arm was broken, we met that particular professional first. You know both of them very well, right, Manish? So he said he's not accountable. We sat there. He said, no, I'm not answerable to anybody. Absolutely unapologetic that the child's arm was broken during therapy and still now nobody knows why. Totally unaccountable. Preeta sat there and cried. And I'm like, no, this cannot happen. So we went and met the head of that association, Occupational Therapy Association, and he was also the same. And that was somebody I really looked up to earlier until then. And he also said the same, that our professionals are not trained. So I said, okay, if your professionals are not trained, then isn't it all the more reason that you have the mothers inside to support? Then the mothers know their children better. So why don't you work together with the mothers? But somehow there was a very strong hierarchy that professional is here and parent is here. So whoever is helping or is considered as helping is supposed to be above. And it's also, it never occurred that there is so much to learn from each other. That together concept did not even exist, I realized. And the extent of power that the professionals had, I realized, and which was, trust me, I felt so ashamed as a professional myself. I felt very ashamed that how can I see this and just let this pass? I think those two reactions from those two people got me angry. And I think activism comes when you are angry. And I was so angry with, that whole thing. And we had to do something. That is when I contacted whoever I could with my previous work, Vaishnavi ma'am, and everybody came together. And I didn't know anything about law, nothing. So it was from the start. So the activism came out of anger. Not because I had any support, but I think the emotion drove me forward.
It was an emotion. Yeah.
Absolutely.
So like you said, how it all kind of started and you went on to becoming someone who was an active professional, of course, working for the same field, but you also started having a dual role of being a kind of a parent advocate or a spokesperson or an activist while you were also a professional at the same time. And I, like you said, you are also a professional now as well, right? So what were what would you say were the ups and downs in this whole journey of your professional being going towards an activism,
yeah,
starting your own thing or something relating to it, and in kind of a movement something relating to it? What were the ups and downs that you had?
A lot of downs. In fact, initially, because I am this professional and not, it's like you're neither here nor there. In the professional community, I was here talking about how professionals should not have been. I was, really, really talking strong. But on the other side, in the parent community, I was not technically a parent, because if my children are neurotypically, then I'm not considered an affected party. So then everybody asked me, what is wrong with you? What is your problem? Because it was like, if I don't have a child with disability and if I am not personally affected, it's not my problem.
Okay.
So if it's not my problem, that means you should have a hidden agenda. So what is Seema's motive? So my motive was questioned pretty harsh. again by the unfortunately one person again tried to turn it as a personal battle against me. I was individually targeted, and the biggest a low point for me personally was the huge Facebook trolling that happened on the Kerala Occupational Therapy Association page when I it really affected me. But then that is when everybody around me, I saw the power of the mothers who were around me. They totally took on. And that is when I knew, when I became vulnerable, the others who I thought were vulnerable and I had to speak up to, they really stood on and you know, they really spoke up. And that I realized that, okay, this is the moment. And that was actually that the all-time low turned to an all-time high. We used it to highlight the issue. If a professional can be targeted so badly, imagine what will they do to a parent who's already vulnerable. Imagine when I am speaking with experience and with the so-called qualification and still you are targeted. So imagine what about a young mother who's still confused about the diagnosis, who's still upset. Imagine if they are the ones going to such professionals, what would be her plight? So that was even more shocking to know that, you know, this huge divide is there where there is no mutual respect. You know, a parent should respect a professional and a professional to respect a parent, and they are equal partners. You know, and ultimately it is the journey of the parent. It is not the journey of the professional. You can leave your job and go tomorrow. It is the mother or the family who has to raise the child. So somewhere there was no equal partnership. So the all-time low became an all-time high, and I should be very grateful to whoever trolled me. It was a huge group. And many people didn't even know what was happening. But you know, the minute you are a woman, it becomes more. My inbox was flooded with filth. And many people said that I should take to court. But then I didn't want to make it my personal journey because the larger issue would be lost. Because that was the whole agenda. The agenda was to turn it personally against me, but I didn't want to make it because it was not about a specific center. It was not about one therapist or one therapy center or one state. It was about how our rehabilitation system or our disability sector, you know, how we say nothing about us without us. So then where are the parents? Why are the parents not part of the at least the therapy program? Why are they not part of an IEP program? Why are they not being trained? Why are you keeping them away? That didn't really make sense. So that was the main agenda. So we had to highlight that. So I think that was possible thanks to a lot of media support. I must say Sudha Nambudiri of Times of India, I have to mention her name everywhere because she turned the whole thing around and she kept writing. She still follows through her journey. In fact, she's now one of our members itself. You know, she turned around our advocates when we filed the public interest litigation. Before we filed it, we had explored all our other options. We had sent a petition to Child Rights Commission. We had sent a petition to collector, to the then minister, the party changed, the new minister. We had explored all options. And there were times when we were just waiting, seeing, okay, nothing is happening. It was very frustrating. So the wait was very, very long. Then whenever an order would come, we had floods. So again, we would go back two steps. You know, so it was not easy at all. There was extensive follow-up and the mothers started giving video campaigns, not only in Kerala, it really caught on. And I should mention Ruchika's name, and I'm sure you know, that's how you also, you were the first occupational therapist, Manish. I have to be most grateful to you. You spoke up for us when we were being totally bashed up saying, oh, she has motives. You spoke up about transparency and ethics as an occupational therapist, and that made a huge difference. We had several other wonderful occupational therapists from outside of states and even the country who came to support. Ruchika gave me a lot of direction, I must say. You know, she was a huge support to just keep motivating, you know, saying that you can do it. So she is my go-to person sometimes. And even Padma and Anita, who are the other two founders of Together We Can, Anita is the one who will calm me down. When I get too angry, she said, Seema, easy, slow down. So she is a big support there. And Padma is the person who I will go to when I'm low, when I'm crying and I'm on the verge of, I'm not doing this anymore, I'm done. Padma is the one who will say, no, 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 we can do it. So, we have to access the right kind of people. We can't sit here and think that, okay, somebody will come and help me. Nobody is coming to save anybody. We have to save ourselves. We have to fight and ask for what we want. That is the only thing that will work. And I think the in the Kerala government also, we were very lucky. We had we found the right people who understood. We were heard, and that also definitely made a difference. We had the right person in the social justice department, in the child rights commission. There are nice people everywhere. Just that we have to keep looking, and we will find them. Don't give up. You know, you can't give up. This is not something you can give up.
So for all the viewers and also for me, tell us something about Together We Can. I mean, what is Together We Can? What does it do? What is it that it has started or accomplished out of this all these related incidences probably? And I'm happy to know that it's not just about one particular center or person or something. It's about, and that's how we also got connected, was about the ethical practice.
Yes.
Was to my mind, where my support is for is always for ethical practice, for things rightly done, for evidence-based practice also, although more from the academic angle. But I would like to know a little more for, and also for the viewers, what is Together We Care? What is it does it that it does at present? And what is it that it kind of, out of this, all this journey, what was the Together We Can journey?
Yeah, Together We Can primarily started as just a WhatsApp group with just the four of us. We moved to a Facebook page where our, I would say 100% of our campaign was on social media, on Facebook. It was all the mothers who spoke up. We really wanted mothers or families to speak up. So that was there were a lot of mothers who came forward. So we just started a campaign to first just building awareness that mothers, ought to be participant in your child's journey. You need to get trained. It is not enough if somebody else is doing therapy and you just sit there and watch. You have to take on, it's your child, and that makes a big difference, and it is possible. Therapy is not rocket science. It is not big surgery. You know, I'm sure you will agree, right, Manish? Occupational therapy or psychology or special ed or speech and language therapy. As a mother, you have to learn everything. Not only the mother, the father, the whole family needs to be aware of, it is not much about this whole diagnosis need not bother you. If you look at your child as a child first, if we understand basic child development skills, basic physiology, neurology, I mean, you can really work with your children. So Together We Can's main objective was to simplify and tell the parents that this is easy. This is very much possible. All of us can do it. We don't need big education background or degrees or certificates are not necessary. Who's becoming a mother by getting a degree? You know, we all just have babies, right? Did we know how to raise children? No. So similarly, nobody knows how to raise children. We are all learning. And also, we wanted to tell the mothers that as professionals, we don't work with one child for the rest of our lives. We work with multiple children for little times, but we have probably the knowledge of skills and strategies and things like that. But that particular child, who has more knowledge, the professional or the parent? It is the parent. It is always the parent. So that knowledge is very valuable, and we had to make the mothers and the families believe that their knowledge is very valuable and it is important. And you can't just That when you keep that knowledge away, and if the professional is only working with their part of the knowledge, we are not going to see much progress. We might see initially and then it will get stuck, because if our larger goal is independent living, then where are the children living now? They are living in their homes. So all these independent living goals should happen now at home, at whatever age your child is. So that was a strong message we wanted to give through TWC, but we needed the support of professionals also. Thanks to professionals like you and Speech and Language Therapy Association in Kerala, a lot of speech and language therapists spoke up, and they also said that yes, the parents have to be participants, home program is important. So a lot of awareness happened through our social media page, and we also filed a petition to bring in regulation of therapy centers. Therapy centers in the country is currently an unregulated sector, which means anybody can start a therapy center now at the moment, not in Kerala anymore, because in Kerala, we have, as on June 24th, 2020, finally, after 5 years of petitioning and case and RTI and everything, we have a rule now under the RPWD rule. We have a very clearly, it is mandated that all therapy centers must be registered under the Social Justice Department. Parent participation is mandatory, documentation is mandatory, parent training is mandatory. So in Kerala, it is mandatory, but of course the difference is that that came in June 2020 when all the children are anyway at home with the pandemic. So wasn't it much necessary before? You know, now all children are at home, the parents are expected to take on. So many are struggling because many didn't know. So the Together We Can's journey was to bring in the regulation, which we brought in Kerala. Now, what we are working towards is to bring it to the rest of the country. The work is still in progress, but hopefully we will get there. Simultaneously, I had to personally move into research also, because I wanted to, like I said, when people were targeting me as an individual, I needed backing of institutions. So my research is it is in tie-up with the BAM, which is the Banyan Academy of Mental Health and Leadership, and the Freyr University in the Amsterdam, Netherlands. So their research is a transdisciplinary research which talks about how all the stakeholders are equal participants in making, you know, whatever, everybody's role is important. So that is what Together We Can is all about. It is to say that if the child is in the center, all of us are working for the safety, dignity, and well-being of the child. We all have much clarity on our objective. So what is the next? Who is the next around the child? The closest to the child is next is the family. So the family's role is very, very crucial. After that only comes the significant other family members, which is extended family, things like that. Then comes the professional. So professional is also important. It is, there has to be a mutual learning. Then comes your society, the laws, the policies, everything indirectly affects our children. So we, all of us have to work together, learn from each other, and then only we will get to a reasonably healthy and inclusive society. And also we wanted to break this whole charity model of working with disability. The minute you say you're working with special needs, oh God bless you. Why is this suddenly bless everybody? Of course, I'm not saying don't bless, but why is this blessing suddenly coming only if you're working with a vulnerable group? So, you know, that is like, you know, punyam, karmam and all that. It's the right of the child. It's your duty. It is there. The basic dignity of life is there in our constitution itself. So it's not a big favor that we are doing. It's not a big charity that we are doing. It's your job, you know, so do your job well. And fine, you want to pay for it. People can, you know, I'm not saying don't make money or anything, but you know, have some ethics. Some transparency, have accountability of what you do. That is what we wanted to bring forward. And there is a Facebook page. I don't know how to share it, the link over here, but it is a Together We Can has a Facebook page in which all the orders, all the petitions, everything is there on the page. And we are also not only looking at therapy, we are moving to inclusive education is another area that we would be taking up, and also eventually about this whole thing about independent living, which is now, you know, a lot of talk is there about long stay homes and, you know, segregated setups for children with autism. So we have to work backwards. How come that is happening for autism? And how come we didn't have segregated setups for Down syndrome or cerebral palsy or any other disability which we knew about way before autism was there? So how come this segregation for autism is becoming a need? So we need to work backwards and see where is it, you know, where is the gap? You know, how do we fill that gap? How do we, you know, are we kind of pushing, you know, a different kind of that first 15 years when the child is supposed to be in school and therapies? So what did we do as professionals? If, you know, our children had to end up in a segregated community, where did we, I wouldn't say go wrong. I would rather say, what can we do differently? That is what we are addressing. And also my personal PhD research is also talking about a shift from this very medical diagnostic model to a more family-centered, individualized model, which will really value the knowledge of the family. Because if you see in India also, if you see the most successful places, it is a parent. If you look at Mary Ma'am, if you look at Akila, if you look at all the parents, you know, they are the best parent. Like I saw your Aparna Das, these are all family members. So that is what, you know, how they are making a huge difference. So, you know, I have not seen such a setup. If you look at any good setup, that is, there is a family member there. It's not entirely run by professionals. I don't know. So that is where I feel, then what are we doing as professionals? You know, so why are we not doing this together? Why don't we come together? And then we can do a even better job for our children, isn't it? So, yeah, that's what Together We Can is hoping to do. We do have consults. I mean, after post-COVID, of course, we couldn't have the one-to-one consults, but we attempt to do it online whenever feasible. Yeah, so that is in brief about TWC.
So, like you said, or told me about your journey. In fact, you also said how few things are there which where you have been very successful also, like regulation, legislation is something that you are really, really successful also. I also want to share with you that actually, even the therapists have really welcomed your success, your victory over getting regulated or getting some regulations over therapy centers. I myself had received so many messages from therapists of active members, therapists of Kerala, actually celebrating
okay.
that the regulations have actually come out and the regulations have actually come into, you know, it's the first step to actually get into the implementation. I'm very sure that it's not just about you or your close friends or your the parents community, even the therapist community have really welcomed your success and the actual thing that has been accomplished in terms of getting regulated. And I was just wondering that how vulnerability is so close to our field overall. It's not about occupation therapist or psychologist or anyone. The whole field of this of parent and children and the therapist taken together as an ecosystem, are so close to the word vulnerability, because there are several types of vulnerabilities, like I was discussing earlier before this program. In fact, even the therapists themselves are so vulnerable that people like occupational therapists, even after they might be doing the noble job that you were saying, that there is so much of a nobility in our jobs.
Why should there be nobility? There is, I mean, I am trying to say that let us not attach nobility. Let us believe that we are just doing our jobs. It is the right of the children. So let us not attach nobility or a halo to anything that we do. We are trying to break that nobility, Manish, because
even after that kind of value addition that therapists have, I feel and I understand and I see that therapist, the occupational therapist, is ultimately left to fend for himself or herself.
Okay.
There is not much support that the therapist gets from probably the government or a structure or system. It's not that the therapist does not want to get regulated, because so many states have their own councils, state councils already formed. And they are being formed by therapists as an initiative.
Mm-hmm.
And they are so happy about having a part of the council.
Mm-hmm.
Because if the therapist who is genuinely working, ethically working, transparently working, at least these therapists will have an ability to advocate themselves, to advocate their own work. What I see as of today, is that because these therapists are left to fend for themselves, sometimes there is an unawareness, and sometimes the marketing throngs just take over and just take the benefit out of the therapist and the therapist skills and the work that they actually want to do. That is also a vulnerability that I see is already evident and is happening. And the other vulnerabilities, like I said, is about children, like you said, parents and children taking therapy. I myself, I'm aware of, like I said, that there was a child having special needs, but a child having special needs who is a girl is perceived as having even more vulnerability by the family itself. That sometimes they may or may not even offer or come up for inclusive education, for vocational training, for therapies, for any kind of programs, just because they feel, how is she going to manage herself relative to this, to the whole mindset of that the girls are typically more vulnerable. I have seen that as well in parents, that their vulnerabilities or feelings of perception of vulnerabilities itself is very close to them, maybe gender-wise or otherwise non-verbal or having speech problems. So Seemaji, then what's the way ahead? What are you thinking? What are you planning? What are you trying as a vision? What's the way ahead now for all the parents, the community as a whole, that includes the whole ecosystem?
I think for the parent, because mostly we are working with mothers here, I think the vulnerability starts with first being a woman, then being a mother. It increases because suddenly you're having to give your, I'm talking about the majority, I'm sure there are exceptions, no doubt. You're having to give up your career. And then you have a child who is, labeled as different. You get a diagnosis. Most often the blame comes on the mother, saying that it's something because you did something happen. So dealing with all of that is not easy. There is a need for support. So a support system has to come up from the parent group itself. No, and not only that, it can't be always the women. What has happened? The fathers. The father's role is exceptionally crucial. And I was so moved by, you had interviewed Devashish also. So he explained it so beautifully. So I think everybody must watch that video on what fathers can do. So it has to be a together journey from there onwards. And to your question of what can professionals do, and if a professional is feeling vulnerable, the best thing is to do is keep the parents together with you, train the mother. It is when you start working with the girl child, the children, and you feel that, oh my God, is somebody going to question you on your ethics or transparency and accountability? there is no need for vulnerability if you are open and transparent, have the parent inside, train the parent. So after some time, the parent doesn't need you. So I would say, why not all the therapy centers or therapists become parent training centers or parent empowerment centers? Then there is the question of vulnerability. We are together in this, so we support each other, you know. So I Together We Can is never going to start a therapy center, but what we do is parent empowerment. We are not working directly with any child or a person with a disability. We are working with the parents or the families to say that we are only facilitators. So there we are not feeling vulnerable because we are learning from each other and creating a enabling society. So where is the vulnerability? We are also becoming stronger. So as therapists, anywhere, occupation therapist or special educator or psychologist, anyone wants to move out of this vulnerable space saying that, oh my God, we don't have an association or whatever. Don't worry. Keep the parent with you. Empower the parent, you know, that is the way to get, they will give you the power. You know, like I said, when I was trolled heavily by the profession group, the parents stood up for me and I was supposed to be, you know, supporting their vulnerability. So, you know, there is a lot of power when we support each other. So I think let us move from this therapy model, diagnostic model, to a parent empowerment or a family empowerment should be our biggest goal. Improving the quality of life of the family. It is not pulling a child out and, you know, seeing the child in a very clinical kind of setting need not really help the family. That is when the professionals feel vulnerable. They will start questioning, where is the progress? Therapist will say, you are not doing work at home. Parent will say, you are not doing, you took so much money from me and there is no progress. Yes, then the professionals will feel vulnerable because there is a blame game. The idea of Together We Can is to break this blame game. If we are together, if each of us know exactly what we are doing, there is a vulnerability, there is a beautiful understanding, there is a beautiful sharing of knowledge of the therapist and the knowledge of the parent, and we grow and learn together, and slowly the professional can become progressively unnecessary. You know, that's what Together We Can does. We are working with families. Thanks to COVID, we are because a lot has moved online, we are able to see the fathers also. So far we rarely got to see the fathers because they're making money for these therapies. So now when you empower the mothers, they should need us lesser and lesser. So, you know, I don't understand why should the professionals need not feel. If anybody is feeling vulnerable, come, contact Together We Can. We can work together on how to, you know, move forward. It's possible. It is surely possible. Yeah.
I'm sure. I'm sure that would be a good and nice way. There could be certain models that can be developed, you know, that are not just for empowerment, but also making sure how the, like you said, the community-based work is, of course, an onus on the parent still. The actual community-based work is done by the parent themselves. And
the community. Yeah.
And the community. So can there be models that can be, you know, like the word Together We Can is, can the entire of these models of professionals, parents can go together. In fact, occupational therapy has a very established model, which is called as family-centered intervention. And it is part of our textbooks. There's nothing, it's not that that we as therapists are not being aware of the global way of doing interventions or the research that is in the background, and they all talk about family-centered intervention. They also talk about child-centered intervention, where they say that the child would be the center and the family member would be a team member of the whole. This is and already an existing teamwork in all of our textbooks.
Yes.
So I'm sure it's a matter of believing. believing
It's a
in it,
matter of
writing,
intent. Yeah, true, true.
then taking it forward in a way that is beneficial clinically, also professionally, ethically, transparency wise as well.
Totally, totally.
There are a lot of comments on the FB page. I'm sure there are not many really questions as such. One of the comments by Kavita George is, I think inclusion is still a dream for many. I think there should be more trained resources. And also more parents should get trained to make the right decision and right time, or at right time, I assume. So there are comments, there are some kind of reflections on it. I don't think there is any questions here, but in the end, if you would like to end up with any kind of a message for the parents who have viewed the program and who have commended, they all have applauded you as well, as to say more power to you. So I'm sure they all stand with you. If you have any concluding message for all the parent community.
Concluding message would be what my thesis is also hopefully going to conclude. So I can say it's evidence-based very soon. To put it briefly, I would say our current diagnostic medical model is built on a checklist of deficits. It is labeling a child based on a long list of things that the child cannot do. Okay. So obviously, any parent is going to go through the whole grief process. But if we all of us can come together as professionals, parents, and of course the child, and safeguarding the dignity of the child and find out what is the strength of the child. Let us build a beautiful strength-based model. There is a lot that the child can do. So let us look at a basic, good old, go back to the older textbooks, which only talks about basic child development skills. Just how your brain works, how your physiology works, and use it specifically to your child. Because no two children are the same. Even if you get the same diagnosis, it's not the same. So let us not be so stuck up in this medical diagnostic model. Let us work with children together with a strength-based model, because and with true intent. Inclusion can start with intention. It has to start with, like I say, the five I's. It has to start with intention. It has to, and who has the most intent? The family, of course. It has to start with the next I, which is in-depth knowledge about the child's interest. And who has that knowledge? The family has that knowledge. It has to start with a lot of interaction with the right kind of people. Interacting with who? Professionals, society, and who has to take the lead for interaction? Again, it is the parent. So let us not leave the parents or the families who are considered as beneficiaries, because I think all of us benefit in the process as a society. And it is a right. And let's do it. We can, and together we can.
Sure. I have an interesting comment from Kavita George, which could be a food for thought for you, for all of us, just to conclude. And she says, but here I would like to mention that not all parents want to, or rather have the bandwidth to work with the child. Without coming across as being biased, I do find that parents in South India being far more to being trained and being involved in the child's intervention. However, it may not be in other parts of India.
That's a
You know what that message says?
huh.
It message says, Seemalalji, when are you coming to North India? Make a base here and start working here and here.
Manish ji, you are there. You are going to take the lead. And I think if a parent does not have the bandwidth, we need to find out why. What happened? Is there a what is the vulnerability of the parent? What is the support system that the parent has? What can we do about it? So it is about finding solutions. There will always be issues. None of us are the same. Just like our children are not the same, no two mother is the same, no two family is the same. So if a family or if a mother feels that, oh no, I cannot do this. Let us try to understand what happened. There must be some reason. Otherwise, no mother is going to say that, no, I'm not going to work with my child. There must be some difficulty. So let us help, and let us help each other. And not only Kerala, I'm sure I know wonderful mothers in the north. Quite a large number of wonderful mothers in the north. Ruchika, where are you? You know, so many of them. I know I'm not getting quickly the names, but wonderful mothers. And Kavita also, she's such a wonderful mother. I've met the whole family. So let's, of course we can do it. It's possible. So Manish ji, I'm sure you will take the lead in the north.
Sure. I think with that, we would like to conclude this program. We are just in time.
Yeah.
And I would say all the best for what you have already started, what you already accomplished, and what all the vision is. I think it is the whole ecosystem needs to be improved. Like I said, I firmly believe that even therapists are not different, any therapist, are not different in this kind of process. They are very much like parents, like Kavita ji said. There would be parents who might not be available psychologically, physically. Similarly, there would always be therapists. The whole ecosystem can't be perfect. There will always be certain things which needs to be ironed out, which we will iron out as together.
Together, absolutely. Thank you so much, Manish ji, for this opportunity. Thank you very much.
Good night, everyone.
Good night. Yeah, thank you.